Jesus, come, King Jesus, Son of God, Son of Man, Messiah.
Hail, King Jesus, King of all.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Please join me in the call to confession, followed by the silent confession. O Lord, who on this day entered the rebellious city that later rejected you, we confess that our wills are as rebellious as Jerusalem's, that our faith is often more show than substance, that our hearts are in need of cleansing. Have mercy on us, Son of David, Savior of our lives. Help us to lay at your feet all that we have and all that we are, trusting you to forgive what is sinful, to heal what is broken, to welcome our praises, and to receive us as your own. Amen. Your God has come to you humble in the form of a slave to free you from the weight of sin and death. Jesus' obedient suffering has released you. Your sins are forgiven in the name of the one who is exalted beyond what we can comprehend, Christ our Savior and Lord. Thanks be to God. Hosanna in the highest.
I would like to invite all the children to come forward. Good morning. You guys did such a great job bringing in the palms this morning. It's a special day, isn't it? What is it today? You guys got it. Perfect. Okay, and it's also the beginning of Holy Week. Can you guys say Holy Week? Okay, now Holy Week starts with Palm Sunday and it ends next Sunday. It's kind of a big deal around the church. What is it? Easter. You guys... Next Sunday is Easter. We got to get that one. All right, well, Palm Sunday, I want you guys to help me remember all of the details. Palm Sunday is when Jesus came into Jerusalem and he was riding a what? Perfect. And then people put coats on the ground as he entered and they waved. You guys know the story. And then what did they shout? You guys should be up here. This is great. They were so excited to welcome Jesus, right? Now, in Sunday school, I asked some of you guys, what would we do if Jesus came in a parade and they came to our church? What would we do to welcome him? Do you guys want to share some of it? What did you guys raise your hand if you know, if you remember? Grady, what would you do? Would you give him a big hug? Yeah? Give some what? Give him a kiss. I love it. I would go give Jesus a big hug and a kiss. Here, let me see if you can remember. Miss Dana, will you hold up? We made him a sign in Sunday school today. It says, welcome Jesus. Wouldn't he like the sign? You guys had some other good ideas too. One of it was to make him a lot of food, right? Because we're in the South. We like to cook, right? That's right. And then maybe we would have a band and we would play some instruments and make it really loud and exciting. Wouldn't that be fun? Well, you know, Jesus doesn't need to be celebrated just in a parade like on Palm Sunday and on Easter. We can celebrate Jesus anywhere. Have you ever gone hiking and saw a beautiful mountain or maybe a beautiful river? All you have to do is say, God, that's awesome. And that's praising Jesus too. So here's what I want you to do this week. You have homework, but it's fun homework. This week, I want you to look for Jesus, and I want you to look for ways to praise Jesus this week. Can you guys do that as we get ready for Easter on Sunday, as we celebrate him on Holy Week? Okay, good deal. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for being so awesome. Help us to praise you each and every single day this week as we get prepared for Easter. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Okay, if you're going to children's church, you can get lined up to go with Miss Dana or go sit back with your parents.
Join me in the prayer for illumination. Let your word, O God, break open our hearts this day through the power of the Holy Spirit, that we may enter into the coming Holy Week with the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Very much. Y'all did a great job. School system makes it harder and harder for us to celebrate Holy Week at church, with spring break always being equivalent to Holy Week. We thank you for being here today and for leading us in music. Scripture reading today is Luke's version of the events of Palm Sunday. It's found on page 83 in the New Testament section of your pew Bibles if you would like to follow along. Chapter 19, verses 29 through 44. When Jesus had come near Bethphage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." As Jesus came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, "If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you and hem you in on every side. They will crush you to the ground, you and your children within you, and they will not leave within you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation from God." May God bless to our hearing and understanding this portion of the word. Amen. In J.R.R. Tolkien's classic, The Lord of the Rings, as a huge battle is about to begin at a place called Helm's Deep, King Theoden looks out and sees the approaching army coming across the battlefield and utters the classic line, "And so it begins." I couldn't get that line and that image out of my head as I focused on the events of Palm Sunday, which began our remembrance of Holy Week. I envisioned Jesus climbing up on that donkey on top of the Mount of Olives and looking across the Kidron Valley at the magnificent city of Jerusalem with the new Temple of Herod standing front and center, and thinking that to himself, "And so it begins." His life and ministry have led to this pivotal point. He has warned his disciples what would happen in this city. He understands it clearly, even if they do not. The ministry of Jesus up to this point is dominated by action words, it seems to me. Preaching, teaching, healing, feeding, touching, walking, and so forth. Holy Week has plenty of action too, but it seems to me that emotion words take center stage now. I think of emotion words for this week that run the gamut from joy, excitement, hope, to sorrow, anger, resentment, guilt, love, grief, despair, relief, and on and on. I wonder what all the emotions were that coursed through Jesus as he sat on the donkey looking across at the holy city. There had to have been excitement, I think. The road was packed with pilgrims coming to the holy city for the Passover festival. Envision Christmas Eve in Vatican City awaiting the Pope's Christmas message. Envision Muslims arriving in Mecca for Ramadan. Imagine Americans clogging I-95 this week on the way to Disney World. This is the only time Luke tells us that Jesus visited Jerusalem, so he would have been astonished as he looked at it and reflected on its history. Psalms of ascent would be sung by the pilgrims as they approached the city, and that would be a real spiritual high. I think there would have been a sense of clarity for Jesus as well. When we get to critical moments in our lives, a rush of adrenaline seems to help us focus and meet the challenge before us with vigor. Ask any choir director if there is a difference between the rehearsal right before the service and what happens in the service, and you'll get abundant proof. For a long time, Jesus had been nibbling around the edges with his being the Messiah, often telling people, "Don't tell anyone about this," or "My time has not yet come." But now the time has come. And he mounts the donkey as an enacted parable to show openly that he is the fulfillment of Old Testament messianic prophecies. There's no turning back now. You have to be fully committed. Perhaps there was also a sense of dread for Jesus, though, knowing the hardships that lay ahead. the Jesus who prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, asking his Father if it was possible that the cup of suffering be removed, that there be some other way to accomplish what must be done, was not immune to such human emotions. He was, after all, fully human, as well as fully God. The conflict, the rejection, the condemnation, the thorns, the nails, those were real experiences for Jesus, not sham illusions where it just looked as though he was experiencing suffering and death. The disciples and company of followers of Jesus played their parts in the enacted parable, laying down their cloaks to extend the red carpet treatment for Jesus into the holy city, praising God joyfully in loud voices, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Now, this is not the crowd in general, and it's certainly not the residents of Jerusalem. Luke is clear to point out that it is the disciples of Jesus, the ones who have witnessed all of his deeds of power, who are making these claims. I can imagine a lot of people around that day wondering what in the world this was all about. Among the crowd with Jesus were Pharisees, as there always seemed to be. And in Luke, it's pretty clear that all the Pharisees don't hold the same opinions about Jesus. And that's again true here, as Luke says that some of the Pharisees who were in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." As Fred Craddock says, we don't know what tone of voice they said that in. It's not clear whether they were appalled at the messianic claim and thought it was blasphemous, or whether they were concerned for the safety of Jesus, or whether they just didn't want anything done that would rile up the Roman guards as Passover celebration started. You may remember that earlier in Luke, some of the Pharisees came to Jesus and warned him that Herod was after him, wanted to get him. But whether stern or friendly, these instructions from the Pharisees to tell his disciples to be quiet sets the stage for one of the most memorable lines Jesus has. He says to them, "I tell you, if these people were quiet, the very stones would shout." This is not a little feel-good moment for a backwater Messiah and his friends. This is the beginning of a God thing, an earth-shaking event, a world-changing moment in time. In the next paragraph, Jesus will use the word kairos, which means God's time, as opposed to the word chronos, which means simply chronological time. And so, he is saying, it begins. As they continue the journey across to Jerusalem, Jesus looks out over it again and weeps. He laments its sad history of turning away from God time and time again, of rejecting the prophets who have been sent to it, of having so much promise and never living up to it. He foresees a day when it will be destroyed because it did not recognize the time, the kairos, of its visitation from God. It could not see or accept that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. This may have just been the beginning, but Jesus knew exactly how this story was going to end. So Luke tells this story about Jesus and his disciples enacting a parable as they entered Jerusalem. Not a great acclamation by the crowds in general in Jerusalem. The symbols are carefully chosen. The colt to be used has never been ridden because in Judaism it was important for sacred occasions to use animals which had never been used for another purpose. The donkey calls to mind the prophecy in Zechariah, "Behold, your king comes to you humble and mounted on the colt of a donkey." A warrior king, of course, would have entered the city on a war horse. King who comes in peace rides a donkey. The garments are spread on the road in respect and honor. The shouts of the disciples echo Psalm 118 about the entry of a king. The meaning is clear to the Pharisees who are looking on, and at least some of them are offended, whether that's the ones who spoke or the ones who were quiet. The ones who spoke told him to order his followers to be quiet, and Jesus' refusal to do so sets the stage for this enacted triumphal entry to be a prelude to a week of conflict, which will end in a very different type of victory. If these people were silent, the very stones would cry out. In a very few days, the voices would indeed be silenced, and the stones would indeed begin to cry out. Indeed, all of nature cried out. When Jesus was crucified, the sun stopped shining for 3 hours and the world was in darkness. There was an earthquake and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. The stones of the earth cried out and groaned in witness to the Son of God. Then 2 days later, there was a stone, a very large one, that had a special job. It was to keep the dead body of Jesus confined to its tomb and to keep the followers of Jesus out who might steal his body and claim that he was alive. But the stone had a higher calling and a higher purpose, which was to stand aside and welcome the resurrected Son of God back to life. Even if voices are silenced, the stones will cry out. Fred Craddock writes, "In other words, some things simply must be said. The disciples are expressing what is ultimately and finally true. God will provide a witness, though every mouth be stopped. Opposition to Christian witness cannot succeed, and the truth will come out. It cannot long be silenced." That stones would shout is, of course, a figure of speech. But the expression does remind us that in biblical understanding, the creation is involved in events that we tend to think affect humans alone. Genesis says that the sin of Adam and Eve caused the earth to produce thorns and thistles. Isaiah sings of a reign of peace on earth when cows and bears will graze together and lions and lambs will lie down side by side. Matthew says a special star appeared to announce Jesus' birth, and he says that the earth shuddered, cracking rocks when he died. And all the synoptists agree that when Jesus was put on the cross, for 3 hours there was an eclipse of the sun. All this dramatic language reminds us of that which we sometimes forget, that all life is from God. The whole universe shares together bane and blessing, life and death. And in the final reign of God, the creation itself will be set free from the bondage to decay and will obtain the glorious liberty of the children of God. And of course, if we're silent about that, the stones will cry out. And so it begins, and it will continue with Jesus turning over the tables of those selling things in the temple and calling for the temple to be returned to a house of prayer. We'll continue with direct and fiery confrontations between Jesus and scribes, Pharisees, Sadducees. It will continue with many people being drawn to Jesus and the religious authorities becoming more and more determined that he's got to go. It continues with Judas making the fateful decision to sell out and betray his leader, and with the Romans growing edgier by the day at the constant chaos and infighting that every Passover celebration brings. This week, I encourage you to follow the story along day by day in your daily Bible readings. And then Thursday night, come to First Presbyterian Church for our combined Maundy-Thursday service for communion. And back here Friday night for the Good Friday service of Progressive Darkness. By remembering and entering into the fullness of the story of Jesus during Holy Week, we will then be fully prepared to experience the incredible good news that Easter morning will bring. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. invite you to stand and join me in the statement of faith, which today is drawn from the brief statement of faith that's found on page 37 in the front of your hymn book. We'll be using the paragraph headed with the red numeral 2, "We trust in Jesus Christ." Let us affirm our faith together. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal. Our hymn is number 160. I invite you to turn to that. It's not one that you probably know, but as you follow the words, you'll see why it's so appropriate for this day. Mandy's going to sing first stanza to introduce us to it, and then we'll join her on the second, third, and fourth.
A stable lamp is lighted, whose glow shall wake the sky. The stars shall bend their voices, and every stone shall cry. And every stone shall cry, and straw like gold shall shine.
Seated. As we turn to God in prayer, let me mention just two or three things. First, I want to welcome some colleagues who are with us today. Gordon Rennell, who is our executive presbyter in Foothills Presbytery, is with us. Gordon, please stand. Gordon was here to teach a Sunday school class this morning. We're grateful for your work among us and for your being here today. Is Tom still back there? Tom Ritchie, former pastor, retired pastor now of Young Memorial Church. We're always glad to have you here, Tom. As we pray, please pray for all the events of Holy Week and all the services around the world that will go on in remembrance of it, all who are traveling this week. We do have a special election this week on Tuesday, so I encourage you to vote. And I want to express thanks to Johnny Tucker of our congregation for offering himself for service, and our prayers are with you as you go through this, Johnny. Please join me in prayer. God, we are grateful for a beautiful day on which to gather and give thanks and praise to you, and on which to remember the events of Palm Sunday, which began all of those chaotic and wondrous events of Holy Week, culminating in the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. As we pass through this week once again, we ask that you will be at work in it to remind us of Jesus and his love for us, to remind us of the sinfulness of human beings who then and now continue to reject you, continue to turn aside from your ways. We pray that you will lead us deeply into that story and that remembrance so that we may be prepared to experience fully the joy of Easter when it arrives. We pray for all those who are traveling this week. We pray for safe journeys. We pray for all who are sick today. Pray for those who are giving care to them. We pray for all of those who are involved in the special election this week and for all who will vote. We give you thanks for all those who offer themselves in public service, and we ask your presence with them, win or lose, that you will strengthen them and grant them joy. Pray that you'll grant all of us wisdom as we vote. Pray for our nation, pray for our leaders in this difficult time with conflict all around, within and without. We ask your guidance and your direction for each one in positions of authority. And on this day again, we come to you to pray for those who grieve. We've had so many losses within this congregation this year, and so many families in the midst of grief. We pray for them, and we add to that number the Noyes family today. We ask that you'll surround them with your peace-giving presence as they gather here this afternoon for memorial service. We're thankful for Catherine and for her life and faith and her service to this church and the relationships we all treasured with her. Strengthen her family, we pray. We ask that you'll fill us with your peace and help us to serve you with the gifts that you've given us day by day. We ask all of these things in the name of Christ our Savior, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we come to the reception of the offering, I want to add my thank you to the congregation for your generous response to the mission drive. It was a wonderful success. We also have members of our mission committee and congregation who are at the South Main Chapel this morning, worshiping and providing the meal for that group. So we're grateful for their service. Now let us continue to worship God as we present our gifts to the Lord. God, we thank you for blessing us in so many ways. We ask that you'll help us to be good stewards of everything that you have given us, from our money to our time to our talents. Help us never to be silent about the good news, never to make it to where the stones have to cry out in our place. Strengthen us for your service and take these gifts and multiply them and use them. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I invite you to go forth from this place into the world in peace. Go in the power of the Holy Spirit, returning no one evil for evil, but only good. And may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be and abide with us all from this day forward and forevermore.